some time, because I'd found that those case books that we'd been looking at were a little bit old. There's nothing wrong with old, but could find something different. True crime, classic, rare and unseen. The contents page. It's the introduction. And here, it says, Dr. Hawley Harvey Crippen, murder at Hilldrop Crescent. The case of Hawley Harvey Crippen has gone down. The criminal justice system for the part that cutting edge communications technology played in the arrest. It was the first time that wireless telegraphy had been used to relay information regarding the whereabouts of a murder suspect. Information that led to a dramatic chase on the high seas and the apprehension of both the wanted man and his mistress. Less well remembered are the events that occurred 7 months earlier in January 1910, which precipitated the flight. His medical training here. Crippen was born in Coldwater, Michigan in 1862. He undertook medical training at Cleveland Homeopathic Hospital, taking a sabbatical gain experience at Bethlehem Royal Hospital in London before graduating in 1885. He would have become an eye and ear specialist. But the edges of the medical profession were blurred during that period, and Crippen took devoted a considerable amount of his professional career to dispensing patent medicines. He wasn't above penning hard sell missives extolling the benefits of some miracle cure in an unregulated market that was notorious for the number of quacks it attracted. Below it says, Crippen takes a second wife. In September 1892, he married 18-year-old Cora Turner, the daughter of Eastern European immigrants, whose real name I cannot pronounce. He had buried his first wife just 8 months earlier, consigning the son from that union, Hawley Otto, to the care of grandparents in California. In 1894, he took up employment with Munyon's Remedies, a patent medicine company that specialized in homeopathic treatments. Around the turn of the century, he was dispatched across the Atlantic to oversee the running of a new Munyon's office in London. That field held little attraction for Cora, who was far more interested in the capital's theatrical set. She soon cultivated many friends, and as well as getting some work as a performer using the stage name Belle Elmore, she also became treasurer of the Music Hall Ladies Guild, an organization formed to support female artists who had fallen on hard times. Thank you. Ten's second marriage vary from tender to combustible. The doctor was, by all accounts, docile and indulgent, traits that came in very handy when dealing with an ill-tempered wife who had extravagant tastes and lofty theatrical ambitions. Cora was too lacking in refinement to make the impression she craved on the operatic world, despite the image she sought to project. The couple appeared to drift towards a status quo in which they put up a reasonably harmonious public front while pursuing their separate agendas in private. A house move in 1905 was part of the charade. The Grippins took up residence 39 Hilldrop Crescent in Camden Town, a property large enough for them not to be under each other's feet, and indeed large enough to obviate the need for them to share marital bed. Clandestine affair. The care and expense Cora lavished on her own appearance did not extend to the rest of the household. She was happy to leave 39 Hilldrop Crescent a dirty, chaotic mess. But housekeeping skills, or lack of, appeared not to ruffle her husband. They took in paying guests to supplement their income. It was Grippin who took on most of the domestic chores. The appearance on the scene of a lover is what drove Dr. Grippin to murder. There is evidence to suggest that Cora was unfaithful many times over, whereas Grippin had but a single grand passion, Ethel Leneve was the latter's secretary in Munyon. to conducting a clandestine affair over several years. Matters came to a head in January 1910 when Ethel celebrated her 27th birthday. Having seen her sister marry at 19 and produce 2 children, Ethel yearned to put the mistress's tag behind her and gain the respectability that would attend becoming the wife of a respected medical practitioner and businessman. That they both willed the same end. The Cora Crippen should be an obstruction no longer. There is a suggestion that Cora discovered the affair and demanded its termination. Something Crippen could not countenance. In December 1909, Cora gave the Crippen's bank the required 12 months' notice for the withdrawal of their funds. £600. Was this part of a threat to her husband, or was also suggested merely the action of a supportive wife seeking to raise capital to fund his various business ventures? At Crippen's trial, the prosecuting counsel would highlight this as a motive for murder, though it appears a somewhat meager reward for such drastic action. So this is Miss Ethel Leneve, who was the secretary of the doctor. So that's Ethel, the lover. And this is his wife. Crippen considered taking the more natural option of pressing for a divorce, amicable or otherwise. He obviously soon discounted it. In mid-January, he used his professional position place an order for 5 grains of hyacin hydrobromide. I'm sure I'm not pronouncing that correctly, which in minute quantities, 1/100th of a grain could be used as a sedative. The quantity acquired by Crippen was enough to kill several times over. The fact that the drug was not recorded in any Munyon's ledger was a damning piece of evidence, as was the fact that he obtained it 2 weeks before Cora's death. This was to be no passion of crime, carried out in a fit of rage. Rather, it was the result of meticulous planning on the part of a man desperate to be rid of a slovenly, shrewish wife, so that he could make an honest woman of his long time mistress. This man, on the 31st of January 1910, Crippen invited friends Paul and Clara Martinetti to Hill Drop Crescent for dinner and a game of cards. He had murder in mind, but wanted witnesses who would be able to attest to a convivial evening, should they be required to do so. Indeed, Paul Martinetti had felt unwell that day, yet Crippen made no offer to release him from the engagement, even though it was a cold winter night. It was around 1:30 a.m. when the party broke up. Crippen's work was only just beginning. After the hyacin took its deadly effect on Cora, he dismembered her body removing all means of identification. Also, he thought, many of the body parts, including the head and all the bones, were never found. The likelihood is that some were incinerated. Neighbors recalled much waste burning activity in the back garden, or else deposited in some watery depths, but unaccountably Crippen chose to bury some tissue in the cellar, covering it in quicklime to hasten the decomposition process. His next task was to account Pegora's sudden disappearance, and that required putting pen to paper. Crippen wrote to the Music Hall Ladies' Guild, of which Clara Martinetti was also a member, informing them that it might be some time before they saw their treasurer again. Please forgive me a hasty letter and any inconvenience I may cause you, but I have just had news of the illness of a near relative, and at only a few hours' notice, I am obliged to go to America. It was signed Belle Helmore, Cora's stage name. It soon emerged that Crippen was behind the letter, for he had misspelt his wife's theatrical name, which was written with a single L. He waved that away by saying that he had acted as scribe while Cora was preparing for her hasty was all very odd, though not unduly suspicious. So it says this here is Crippen's house, where the police found the remains of a human body buried under the brick floor of the basement. Traces of scopolamine, a calming drug, were also found. These are witnesses, Miss Lil Hawthorne and Mrs. Stalin, who attend the trial. And this here is Chief Inspector Walter Jew. Thank you. just as here. Series of lies. Let's just see who this gentleman is here. This is Captain Kendall, who alerted Scotland Yard to Gripen's presence on board. And this here is the wireless message he used to alert Scotland Yard. It apparently was the first time such technology had been used to apprehend a criminal. So, Gripen wasted little time before cashing in some of Cora's jewelry at a pawnbroker's. Though first he picked out some pieces for his beloved Ethel. The unseemly speed with which Gripen and Ethel were seen about town, the latter attired in Cora's clothes as well as jewelry, raised eyebrows. Gripen even had the nerve to take her to a ball organized by the Music Hall Ladies Guild less than 3 weeks after Cora's sudden departure. In doing so, he flaunted his mistress in front of some of his wife's dearest friends. It was a month later, mid-March, that those friends became truly alarmed. Gripen reported that Cora had become dangerously ill with pneumonia, but he showed no inclination to listen to their entreaties and take the next available crossing. On the 23rd of March, the stage publication, The Era, carried the news that Belle Elmore had succumbed to the infection. Gripen packed his bags now, though not for America. He took himself off to France with Ethel. The latter claimed to know nothing of Cora's death at this point, though bizarrely she spoke of her engagement to Gripen she was a married woman. No wedding took place, but she and Crippen regarded themselves as hubby and wifey, as they affectionately called each other. Cora's friends were reeling with a kind of shock that evidently was not afflicting Crippen. Further details of the tragedy, but found Crippen vague on the subject. First, he said she had died at his son's house in Los Angeles, but a letter from Hawley Otto Crippen said that he was as much in the dark as anyone. All he knew was what his father had told him, that Cora had died in San Francisco. Crippen claimed it was an error born of confusion. He was asked what boat Cora had taken. Crippen blustered. There was no record of Cora or Bell or any passenger list on any passenger list. This, along with the evidence of their own eyes watching Ethel Leneuve disporting herself around town with Crippen, wearing Cora's finery, was enough to persuade the missing woman's friends to take their concerns to the police. Don't since had to stop the camera and restart again. Myself a cup of tea, so you may see it in the camera now. So let's go back to Cora's friends raising the alarm. On the 6th of July, 1910, Chief Inspector Walter Dew paid Crippen a visit to be informed that Cora had left him and that the story of the sick relative in America had been fabricated as a face-saving exercise. Ethel was there at the time. introduced to June as a housekeeper. This is Chief Inspector Walter June. Gribbin invited the policeman to search the premises, even though he had no warrant to do so, and who appeared to be satisfied. The mild-mannered, cooperative physician might have appeared unflappable, but the visit obviously spooked. For he and Ethel soon hatched their plan for a daring transatlantic escape. First, they went to Antwerp, where they boarded the Canada-bound SS. Says grisly secret. Meanwhile, police had discovered that Gribbin and his accomplice had flown and were swarming over 39 Hilldrop Crescent. The cellars shallow grave soon gave up its grisly secret. While forensic experts got to work on the remains, Drew was in hot pursuit of the fleeing couple. Their descriptions had been widely circulated, and Gribbin must have thought himself clever to have Ethel decked out in boys' clothes so that they might travel as father and child. The disguise didn't fool the Montrose's captain, Henry Kendall, for so long. There was something not quite right about the child's demeanor, or his attitude towards the adult accompanying. He tested his suspicions by calling out to Gribbin by his assumed name, Robinson, and saw that he had to be prompted by his son to respond. Kendall's vessel was fitted with radio communication. Then a fledgling sent a message to London expressing the belief that the Mr. and Master Robinson on his passenger list were in fact Gripen and Lenev. He had more than half an eye on the £250 reward on offer for information leading to the capture of the two absconders. It says here, police and press give chase. The police had already learned that Gripen had sent dental technician William Long to purchase a suit of boys' clothes. So the communication from the Montrose represented another piece of the jigsaw slotting into place. Jew gave chase aboard a faster ship, the Laurentic, which overhauled the Montrose a day before the latter docked. A large brass pack was an attendant for the paths of the two vessels had been plotted in the newspapers, which gave acres of space to the gruesome Camden Town murder. Jew wrong-footed the reporters by boarding the Montrose via a tugboat on the 31st of July. And when he bade Gripen good morning by his real name, there was no attempt at dissembling. I am more than satisfied, when asked for an assurance that he wouldn't jump overboard. The anxiety has been too awful. His immediate concern was to protect Ethel, saying she was a complete innocent. And the latter professed to be shocked when told what had been unearthed in the cellar of 39 Hilldrop Crescent. It says here, Inspector Dew and C. Dennis disguised as pilots in a boat, and they boarded the ship as it entered St. Lawrence River. Dr. Gripen returns to England to face trial. He was tried at the Old Bailey, was found guilty after just 27 minutes of deliberation. Yes. Take a sip of my tea. Okay. We've just got this and this little part here left. experts battle over forensic evidence. Gribben was charged with murder, Ethel with being an accessory after the fact. It was against the husband that the prosecution trained their weapons. They were much less concerned about what Ethel knew and when. The defense counsel contended that there was doubt over the sex of the cellar tissue, let alone that it was the remains of Cora Gribben. One particular piece of skin became the main battleground for rival experts. Eminent pathologists Augustus Pepper and Bernard Spilsbury said he came from the abdomen and bore a scar of the kind that Cora would have been left with following an ovariectomy some 15 years. The defense tried to suggest that it was thigh tissue and a fold in the skin rather than a scar, but Pepper and Spilsbury were imperious in their pronouncements, and the experts lined up to oppose them. Prosecution toxicologists also won the day, countering the defense's argument that the poison might have been the result of the putrefaction process. They convinced the jury that the deadly hyoscine had to have been ingested by the victim. Gribben had made a vital error in using quicklime to destroy the body, for it acted as a preservative for the hyoscine, with preposterousness of the suggestion that he should have turned into a fiend incarnate on the night of the 31st of January. The jury believed exactly that, returning a unanimous guilty verdict in barely half an hour. A week later, Ethel pleaded not guilty at her trial, which lasted less than a day and ended in an acquittal. Having nailed Crippen, the prosecution seemed to have no appetite for the battle to prove Ethel's complicity. So we have Mr. Arthur Newton preparing the evidence at his desk. Superintendent Frost, and these here are witnesses that are gathering at the courtroom. Let's just read the last part. These are just newspaper cuttings. Just add this last bit here. So let's read. Condemned to death, Hawley Harvey Crippen was hanged at Bentonville Prison on the 23rd of November 1910. In one of his last letters, Crippen gave Ethel his blessing to marry, and she did so in 1915 when she was going by the name of Harvey. For 45 years until his death in 1960, Stanley Smith remained unaware that his wife was none other than Ethel Leneve, mistress of Dr. Crippen. Ethel died 7 years later, aged 84. Some believe she was an inveterate liar who profited from Crippen's selfless insistence that she was innocent of all wrongdoing, and that the prosecution could have made a much stronger case against her. But almost a century on, it seems that the precise role Ethel Leneve played in the events at 39 Hilldrop Crescent on the night of the 31st of January 1910 will never be known. That's the story of Dr. Hawley Harvey Crippen. you've enjoyed this first story in this true crime book. By the looks of it, we have many more to go. A series so we can read more of the stories. The more of you leave me comments, the more likely I am to make more of these videos. So please do help me by leaving me a little comment. Also liking the video. Thank you so much.